far as I know.
Okay, then it's Wednesday at 6 p.m. at Alice's house. Our church picnic is going to be Wednesday, September 25th, beginning at 6 p.m. in the large pavilion at the Sermont Park. Please sign up in the back to attend so we know how much chicken to get. And anybody who wants to cook a dish or something, bring it on. Trinity will be hosting a hymn sing on Sunday the 29th at 3 p.m. in the sanctuary here, and light refreshments will be served. With your smiling faces, you may hear wonderful voices and praise in the afternoon. Do we have any joys or concerns? I guess our major concern is several folks from the church have COVID and can't be here with us today. So add that to our prayer list, please. Russ, Ross, and Hoodie.
Okay.
They happen to get COVID. Please join me now in the call to worship. God has gathered us to this place.
We're ready to hear those stories.
Show us the kingdom of God's life. God summons us to his place where we can learn how to serve our God without reservation or hesitation. God will send us from this place
to tell others of God's hopes and dreams,
so they too can choose to follow God.
If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. Yet we often have difficulty living in that new reality, clinging to the old ways that have passed. When we confess our sin, we make room for God's truth to dwell in us, clearing the path for a new way of life. Before God, with the people of God, let us confess our faults and our failings. Please take a moment of silent prayer. Please join me in a prayer of confession. God of unity and love, place within each of us a spirit of hope and community. Have mercy upon us when we speak without love or act without humility. Cleanse us with the living water of your grace. Create in us willing hearts to live in patience and gentleness. Raise us up to be your children, growing toward maturity in faith and love. Strengthen this church that we may be a model of ministry and unity for all the world to see. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We have called out to God, and God has heard our cries. God's merciful spirit is poured out on all people. Our Creator has offered us forgiveness of our sins through Jesus Christ. For we have humbled ourselves before him and sought his mercy, and so we shall be exalted. For these abundant gifts of God's undeserving grace, let us stand and sing praises to him. Number 92, The Solid Rock.
Thank you.
verses 21 through 33. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Here ends the reading of God's most holy word. I went to Frostburg University. It was Frostburg College at the time, and yeah, Ethan was last decade. I met a guy there. I majored in music education, wanted to be a music teacher, and so I joined the music fraternity. And this guy also joined the music fraternity, and we got to know each other a little bit and became friends. In fact, I spent some time at his house. I want to welcome Larry, Lindner, and Belinda. God, I remember the name. Thank you, Jesus.
Good job.
Yeah, this church knows I struggle with that. Belinda, I will remember your face forever. But next Sunday, if you come, I might have to secretly ask Larry, but not which wife's name. Anyway, back to the story. Larry and I became pretty good friends. And so we decided to invite each other to different churches. He at the time was attending a Catholic church, and I at the time, searching for churches, was going to Baptist church. So we decided we're going to invite each other to church. I went to Larry's church first, the Catholic church. We walk in, and there's all these red things with candles in them. I'm like, you know, what's all that? And Larry says, well, you know, if you have a prayer that you want to offer up to God, you light the candle and God will hear the prayer. Okay, all right. So then we got to the pews and there were these things that poured out in front of me. What's this, Larry? Oh, well, you pull those out and that's how you kneel when we do certain parts of the service. Now, I'm right, so far.
Nailed it.
I was going to call you up here, but I do Ethan.
Spot on.
So, but we got through the service they didn't kick me out, so I guess things went well. So then Larry comes to the Baptist church with me, and we walk in, and he's given a bulletin. He says, well, why do you do this? What's this Apostles' Creed thing? I said, well, that's what we recite, although we don't do it here. That's what we recite every Sunday morning because that's what we believe. And when we're young, we're forced to memorize it so that we can remember what we believe. Okay. We sat down and he had another question or two about the service. I can't remember what it was. So the service starts, and we're getting along fine, and then the pastor gets up in front of the church, takes his watch off, puts it right there in front of him. Mine won't sit there. Funny. He said to me, "What's that all about?" I said, "Absolutely nothing." Come on, people. The pastor puts a watch in front of him. I say, "Absolutely nothing." Do I need to explain the joke?
Forgot the rim shot, sorry.
Yeah, the true part is that Larry and I were good friends, are still good friends. I did go to his church when he came to a church with me. I don't remember if it was the Baptist church, but I can tell stories about the Baptist church because I was a Baptist for years and years and years. Now I'm back to my original roots, the Reformed church. But the point there is that if the Holy Spirit speaks to the man standing in front of you, he has to listen. And if he goes over, the watch means nothing. God doesn't have a watch. He doesn't need a watch. He created time. Scripture says that a year is like a thousand, and a thousand years is like one per day. So time is nothing to God. All right? Now, I do not have a 30-minute sermon this morning, so you can exhale. It's okay. So last week, we started the first half of chapter 5 in Ephesians. And let me just walk us through it real quick so that we can get caught up and our guests this morning can know where we're starting from and then continue. Last week, I talked about what I called the three W's. And they were walk in love, walk in light, and walk in wisdom. The first point, walking in love, as we walk in love, let all you do and say glorify God. Watch what you do in front of folks. They are watching. Watch what you say in front of folks. They are listening. Last week I said that I know a man that says I will never ever go to church because it's filled with hypocrites. Are we hypocrites? Think about it. We come on Sunday morning and we worship God and we learn, hopefully, from God. We get something that he wants us to take outside of the building and do. How many of us walk through the door and, okay, the week's starting now, and you don't do what God has spoken to you about? Isn't that really being a hypocrite? Saying one thing, doing another? So we are all hypocrites to one degree or another. I'm not saying that you're a bunch of heathens and you go out and purposefully do the opposite of what God tells you to do. No, I'm not saying that. But I am saying that to some degree we are all hypocrites. And I also believe that this house, God's house, is a hospital for sinners. Because we all have that disease and we all need to be cured. And Jesus is. So, hypocrite or not, you need to be here so you can be cured. Second point was walking in light. Jesus is the light. Jesus is the Word. John chapter 1, verse 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God." Your Bible is a collection of 66 books written by approximately 40 authors, all inspired by God. They did not write it. Their hands did the letters. God spoke to them and told them what to write. So Scripture comes from God. and God's word is true from the beginning to the end. All of it is true. Perhaps part of God's word is hard for us to digest. And let me say right now, folks, I'm sure that God stepped on some toes last week. He stepped on my toes big time preparing for last week's sermon. But truth is truth, and sometimes it's hard to hear it, and sometimes it's hard to apply it in our lives. That's why we need God to help us apply it in our lives. So the Holy Spirit convicts us, and that by that, God corrects us, and he tells us what is true. One of the best quotes in the Bible is from a man who was not a child of God. He was not a prophet. He was not an apostle. He was not anything. Now, this was before Christianity, so I can't say he wasn't a believer, but he wasn't a Jew. He said, and this is Pontius Pilate, he said, "What is truth?" We know that truth is the word of God, and that Jesus, the Son of God, was standing right there before him. That is truth. My third point was walking in wisdom. Let no one sway you from the church. Let no one sway you from the truth. Sorry, the truth. The Bible's true from cover to cover. It does not contradict itself. God does not contradict himself. There are so many false teachers today and so many fake churches. They have caved to preaching words that comfort our current society. Feel good, sir. Hopefully you have felt good sometime since May. But again, I'm going to speak the truth. I'm going to speak the word of God. In our current society, the comfort of current society, they have made wrong right and right wrong. They do not preach the word. They do not preach the truth. They preach what is comfortable for their congregation here, and that's not good. There is a lot of comfort in the Word of God, but it is all true, and sometimes it hurts. So that's not godly. That is not preaching from the Word of God. So many people are confused. Because they hear different things from different pastors, from different churches, they ask, what does the Bible really say? Well, any confusion, hear this, confusion comes from Satan himself. God did not create confusion. God's word has never, nor will it ever change. Not change the truth. Now we're at the second half of Ephesians, chapter 5, verse 22. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, for which he is the Savior. Now, as to the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Gentlemen, again, there are pastors that are misquoting this verse. I've known men who have grossly misinterpreted. They seem to think that they have authority over their wives, and therefore their wives are slaves to them. That can't be any further from the truth. Wives are to submit to their husbands only because their husbands are to submit to Jesus Christ. By submitting to their husbands, wives are submitting to Jesus. I have a friend. When I came back to Washington County from Prince George's County, I went to my home church, and there was, Larry, did you know Charles Grab played trumpet?
Sure did.
Yeah, so he was the choir director at that church, and he and his wife kind of grabbed a hold of me, because even though I was back in my home church, I'd been gone so long, it was like, who are these people? So I got close to the family, close to the kids, and it was also kind of cool. They kind of made me an honorary uncle. Now, but here's the point I want to make. One of the daughters is truly a devout Christian. She submits totally to her husband because Ephesians 5:22 says, here's the problem. His husband was raised in the church, but he had a drug problem. His parents drug him to church every time the door was open. He said, I am not going to do that to my kids. So the pendulum swings all the way over here, and they are not in the church. He is not. She obeys him. In this case, and in too many cases, when I was a boy in that generation of men, kind of backed out of the church, the mothers and the women had to step forward and raise their children as Christian children. Shame on that generation, and shame on any man that is doing that now. Verse 25. Guys, I've already attacked you. Here comes more. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, making her holy, cleansing her by the washing of water through the word, and presenting her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. Who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one has ever hated his own body. He feeds it and cares for it, just as Christ does the church, for we are all members of his body. So here, what Paul is telling us is that the husbands must love their wives just as he, Jesus, loved the church and gave himself to the church. You know what? I'm going to ignore my notes and speak from my heart this morning. Gentlemen, Jesus gave his life for all mankind, which includes women, okay? He gave his life as the perfect sacrifice that we can have eternal life by believing that and giving our hearts and lives to him. When the scripture says here that husbands, you ought to be like Jesus. Are you willing to give your life for your wife? Are you loving her in the same way that Christ loves us? Guys, on it this week, here's my challenge. Just one time. Do the dishes. Vacuum the floor. Make breakfast. Choose one. You are going to be the man of all mans, the husband of all husbandses. Because that's one way you can show your love to your wife. So not only do it, show it to her. Show her that you love her. Support her as she supports you. Because God put Adam and Eve together, and all through the Bible, the men have been in charge, but the women have been the workers. Even with Jesus' disciples, there's women that followed him as well and took care of them. I have this quote, and I want to say it because I think it's pretty cool. You know, here Paul's telling the husbands that they must do the same things for their wives, to be willing to give their lives for their wives in the same way Christ did. He is not saying, if you feel like it, do, then do it. No. This is a command. It's not a, if you feel like it. It's a command. The husband, it is not the husband's right to lead the family. Now listen to the second half of the sentence. As a man of God, it is his responsibility to lead the family as a man of God. We have a lot of rights in society. Okay? Just a lot of them just make us feel comfortable. I have the right to go home and turn on the air conditioner because on the farm, my parents had one in their bedroom and that was it. So, I'm going to make my house cool. I have a right to do that. But I have a responsibility to love my wife and to support my wife and to serve my wife if I want her to obey me. Make sense? Christ came not to be served, but to serve. In verse 33, through the end of the chapter, God's word says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. In Genesis, the second chapter, verse 22, the Bible says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. Moses wrote the book of Genesis, which was inspired by God, where he states, leave his father and mother, talk about the husband, instead of remaining under the protective cover of his parents, and take on that responsibility himself. Husband and wife become one flesh. Even from the very beginning of the Bible in Genesis, God's holy purpose was to unite Adam and Eve. They were to become one and remain together. By that, they made a promise, actually more than a promise. They made a covenant with God. I'm going to pretend that you don't know what a covenant is. God made a covenant He made a promise to Abraham that he would not break. God's covenants are promises that he will not break. When God put Adam and Eve together, they made a covenant with God. In the same way, as Jesus comes again as the bride, as the bridegroom, we are his bride. When he comes for us, which is the church, the international church, not just Trinity, is going to be all believers. God is making the same covenant that we will be joined together with Christ for eternity, with Jesus the Son, with God the Father, and with the Holy Spirit. All three with the bride. We are the bride. Become united. Remember, we are children of God. And there's going to come a point where Jesus returns for his bride, and that is us, the church. So when a man and a woman come together in marriage, it is just a model of what Jesus is going to do. You become united. You work together. And if you raise a family, you do it together. Each man must love his wife in the same way that Christ loves, and will love the church. Let me say it again. Each man should love his wife in the same way that Christ loves the church. And wife, you must respect your husband because his Lord. And Lord means that you listen and do. His Lord is Jesus, God himself. That's why you need to respect him, because in that way, you are respecting God. A man and a woman must become united, seeking God as they grow together. In fact, that's this morning's big idea. Let me say this again for Larry and Belinda. I was taught a certain way to preach, okay? And I had three ideas this morning. And then you have this big idea that you put out there, and the people walk out the door. Yep, that's the big idea. I'm going to, you know, try to, do my best, but I know I can't. So God's going to have to do this through me. And then come back the next week and they know what the big idea is still, right? No. But if you hear it, God's going to do with it what he will if you allow him. Today's big idea: a man and a woman must become united, seeking God as they grow together. That's today's big idea. A man and woman must become united, seeking God together as they grow together. Amen? Amen. Take your hymnals out, please, and open to number 547, the church's one foundation, 547. Please stand again. you now at the conclusion of this service, we just ask God that you would be with us this week. Father, it is no secret that the family is being attacked by the liar himself, being deceived, being drawn away from you. But God, we as your children cannot be harmed by him. He cannot touch us. We may give in. We will give in. That's called sin. And we just ask God that you remind us that we need to ask you to forgive us just as we would expect our children to say, I'm sorry, Daddy. I'm sorry, Mommy. Forgive me. Father, I ask that you help us to be united. Not everyone in this building this morning come or has a husband-wife relationship, but I'm sure they got it. There are women who have to raise children. There are men who have to raise children. Somehow, they have to be both. And God, for those, we ask for your help. Your grace is sufficient. Your help is sufficient. And now, Father, as we go our separate ways, I ask God that you would guide us and direct us in everything we do and say. Be with us, Lord Jesus. Be with us, Lord.